ladies and gentlemen, I think you can hear me, can't you? An old ex-Marine, I am pretty loud mouthed to be a drill instructor and so forth. But a lot of times people ask us why we do what we're doing. Now, to tell you a little bit about us, we're really not as strange as I look. My wife is my refinement, and so I am really pleased with this. But Jody is the mother of 6 children, 3 boys and 3 girls. Our oldest son is down in Tucson as a seminary teacher. He has a little boy and a little girl. My daughter Leslie here has a little boy. My next daughter has a little boy and a little girl. Then my next daughter is in Lima, Peru on a mission and will be home 4 fast Sundays from now. So she'll be with us on the 4th fast Sunday. And I have a son, John. He is in Kobe, Japan on a mission, and they were both in the mission home at the same time. So we have really had some great spiritual blessings in these last year and a half. And as we move down the line, people wonder why we get involved with this. Well, years ago, down in Provo, we had a little theater called the Valley Center Playhouse. And while we were down there, the second year we were there, James Arrington came out of the BYU with his show on Here's Brother Brigham and put it in our little theater for the first time. And then that following Christmas, Bryce Chamberlain came to us and said, can I put my Joseph Smith show on during the Christmas holidays, because we're always closed during the holidays. We said, sure. The second night that Bryce Chamberlain did this, my wife was sitting in the audience watching the show, and inspiration or a little voice or something came to her and says, why don't you do something on the women of the church? And she thought back and she says, well, who's going to do it? And the little voice says, why not you? So she came walking out during intermission, and she walked down the aisle out to where I was, and she said, honey, I'm going to do something on the women of the church. And I immediately, without even thinking, said, if you're going to do one, do the big one. And she says, what do you mean? I said, Emma Smith. At that time, there was nothing written on Emma Smith. It was pretty well negative, all about so forth. So we started writing that, and would you believe that after about a month into this, when we just about had it ready to go, her Relief Society president came to her and said, Jody, we would like you to do something on one of the women in the church. So that's how we got started with this. And then after she had performed that show from the East Coast to the West Coast, from the North and the South, over 300 times. And then she wanted to challenge herself with something else. And Mary has always been something that my wife has been fascinated with. There's not much in the Bible about Mary. So in our research, we started to go into it. And my stake president, Alma Burton, had written things on Mary. And Ivan Barrett, who I would go home teaching to there in our ward, had written things on Mary. And we gathered all these things together in all my little old books that I had written back in 1888 and 1890 and so forth. She came up with this show, how Mary must have felt at the time as this progresses. And I think you'll be caught up tonight, sisters, with the spirit of Mary and some of the challenges that she went through that a lot of times we don't even think about it. And so this is how it revolved around. Now, to tell you what we do, we have a little theater out in Linden where we put live plays on every Friday, Saturday, and Monday night, year-round. We're always playing one show, rehearsing one show, casting the third show, and I'm looking for props for the fourth show. And that's how our life is. And in between this, we have our family, kids going to school, and all these different things. And then we do things like we're doing here tonight. So we love what we're doing. And we appreciate the opportunity of coming here before you lovely sisters and being able to put forth this show on Mary the Chosen. Now, it'll take me just a minute or two to get things set up here for us, and then we'll be ready to go with the light. So we want to thank you.
Thank you. purpose of life has lost its meaning. No longer have I a need of being someone. I continue not. For it is the same as if I myself had been the victim of some evil, vengeful hand. Was the custom of my day when a young woman turned into her early teens. Her parents were visited by young men's parents searching for a future betrothal or engagement. But I had arrived at that age, and already preliminary conversations were being taken. And yet I did not know which man they would choose. Drawing water from the well or walking back along the lanes, I would think and wonder who would it be. And as I thought it would be eligible young men of my community, I wondered, would it be the merchant's son or would it be the caravan, the son of the caravan leader? Would it be the young carpenter? Well, as soon as both families were in agreement, I was told my husband-to-be was Joseph, the young bearded carpenter. Well, I was pleased, for I had always secretly thought him very handsome. Well, not only did he possess the skill of a fine carpenter, but he was indeed an honorable man. And I vowed at that time I would be a good wife for Joseph. Well, he had first seen me in the company of my parents, and he said he felt attracted to me. And then when his parents began to speak of an engagement and marriage, he told them of his attraction for me. The Gideshin, or betrothal ceremony, was held shortly after this. And it was as binding as a wedding. For you see, once the betrothal ceremony was made, the in Palestine and Galilee, a state of purity was maintained until after the wedding. And we spent our year, as was the custom, building a small house and preparing it completely. The marriage came about 1 year after the issue. And it was during that year that a very wondrous thing took place. You see, I was visited by a heavenly messenger. We had always been taught that angels were heavenly messengers. And it was common to hear the elders up and down in all the cities speak of the experiences the rabbis had had. So it was not the visit itself that alarmed me, but it was the nature of the visit. I remember I was all alone preparing for bed when I heard a noise, and as I turned, I saw who are you? Gabriel? What? I am blessed beyond all women. I am to bear a child. I have found sight in favor of the Lord. The child will be the Son of God. But how can this be? For I have not yet known the man. The remainder of the night. And early the next morning, I related the experience to both my parents. Well, they felt the same as I did after much discussion. It was indeed a frightening position to be the one chosen for such a great honor. Oh, the next few days were very difficult. I remember so many thoughts flooding through my mind. Well, you see, I knew that always, that someday a young virtuous woman would be selected to be the mother of the Savior. But, oh, when I said the words, it seemed like blasphemy. Soon, I knew that there was that one way that I would know. And all I had heard was not a dream. And I left early the next morning with my parents' consent for the mountainous town in Judea to visit my kinswoman, Elizabeth. And I'll never forget as I came up the walk. I saw her standing in the doorway, and I waved to her and called her name. And she quickly clutched her side, saying, "Blessed among all women. Blessed is the fruit of your womb. How privileged am I to have the mother of the Son of my God paying me a visit. But hear this, as your words fell upon my ears, the babe in my womb leaped for joy." On hearing the words from the grain of the Son, who had known me all since the moment of my birth. Oh, I was so relieved. I knew for an assurance the child I carried was holy. I stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months, almost until the day foster father, who better than the kind mother Joseph? Why, I did not know. I kept locked deep in my bosom. The greatest announcement God has made to the world. Well, Joseph, poor Joseph, he went away thinking and worrying and wondering. He said at first he wondered if it was not too much to think if he married the gospels of such a small town as Nazareth, would not think his six-month baby remarkable? And then he said he knew he could divorce him, upon which place he would have to admit he knew nothing of the child, and then I would be a judge and adulteress, the penalty being stoned until death. Or he knew he could have me sent away privately, paid to have me sent away to some remote place to have my child and never to return again. He said he thought and thought and thought. And one thing he knew, he could never give his heart to another, for the pain was too great. Well, about this time, sleep came upon Joseph. And in his sleep, he was also visited by an angel. Joseph, fear not to take Mary, your wife, into your home, for her conception was wrought by the Holy Spirit, and she shall bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus, for he shall save his people. You see, that would be a fulfillment, that a prophecy that he would long be acquainted with, and he said he believed this with all his heart. And when he awoke, he came quickly to me with the news. He said he was happy, somewhat bewildered, but most of all he was relieved, for he now understood the whole of the matter. And that was a special time for Joseph and me, because we felt our love and our trust come back. And now we plan our future together. We were married shortly after this, and it was a quiet, simple wedding, but it was a most memorable event in the lives of both of our families. We lived in Nazareth, and it was a good life with Joseph. He had developed his business into a very prosperous life. We spent many hours together talking. And then later, shortly after this, I began to feel life move within me as I lay alongside Joseph at night waiting for sleep to come. It was about this time when Caesar Augustus of Rome, after having a council, he could not decide how to tax his subjects unless he knew how many subjects he had and from whence they came. And so he ordered a direct order for all subjects to return to the home of their fatherland. When I heard this, I told Joseph I did not wish to go, for I was great with child now, and my neighbors had long since warned me not to travel at such a time. And no one had been able to coax me beyond my home or the homes of the nearby neighbors. And Joseph, he told me that it was not a matter for discussion, that it was the law and we had to go. But then he told me we could travel through Jerusalem on the way home. And because I had never seen Jerusalem or King Solomon's temple, and because I was a dutiful one, I agreed to go. And as we made our way along toward the city of our ancestors, I remember I rode silent on a little gray donkey. How often my thoughts go back to that little donkey. It was the same one that Joseph delivered his completed goods to with the arm. donkey, how tired he must have grown, and how useless the journey must have seemed to him. I was tired, and although it was not long, it was hot and dry, and we were sore pressed by the heat of the sun. Did he realize that he played a part in the greatest drama which has ever been given to the earth? His part was small, true, but so many times the small parts are the important ones, and they all go together to make a story complete. It was about an 80-mile journey, and we traveled 4 days, and we had to stay 3 nights, either in wayside inns or we slept with our fellow travelers out in the open beneath the stars. But on the last day, we traveled among the tops of the Judean mountains. Well, this was the very country where our ancestor, as a matter of fact, David, had tended sheep for his father with just a mere boy of 13. And also Ruth, his great-grandmother, had gleaned in the fields of Boaz. Well, we arrived at our destination early evening. Because all the inns and lodgings were filled, we were forced to take temporary quarters in a small stable. But actually, it was a cave, hollowed out in the nearby hillside. And we found an empty stall, and we spread blankets across the fresh-cut straw. And then we put our largest blanket at the entry for privacy. It was clean, and we had no fears, no qualms of being harmed in any way. But I am afraid my husband felt the same as any husband would feel. Such a place was wholly unworthy to be the birthplace of my first child. Yes, my son and the Son of God was born that night. I gave him a bite. Sweet, tiny, warm, and so soft to my touch. And God gave him a spirit, clean, pure, and perfect. And when Joseph first looked into the little tent of cloth, he said, "This is the one whom the angel spoke. This is the Messiah." And it was a labor and a birth such as happens many times each day. But you see, it was part of me, and I have lived it over and over again in my heart. My labor began earlier that day, as we traveled over the valleys and the hills, and I feared that the birth of my baby would come before our destination arrived. We were able to get the services of a fellow traveler's wife, and she was greatly experienced in matters such as this, and she was also a mother herself. And Joseph and I thanked God, for we felt that surely she must have been saved. But it was a good word, and an easy one, she had told him. And I remember thinking, easy? Oh, then what must a hard one be? There were shepherds tending their flocks in the field, and they came to visit us that night to pay their respects to the newborn child. They were such good men, and it might have seemed strange to see him lying in a manger with the most humble circumstances around him. But they were like men priests in the temple. They were good men who had read the scriptures and believed the truth found in them. And they told us of the wondrous experience they glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And the shepherds came swiftly their short mile on the plain from where they were to the spot where they found the newborn babe whom we had just wrapped in swaddling clothes. And that night it gave us happy assurance that others knew of this wondrous thing which had happened. And I thanked God. And that was so sweet to me. Wishing to travel with such a small child, we took a small home in Bethlehem for a few months, and there we were living in some very wise men who traveled great distances, came to visit our son, pay their respects, and with them they brought such fine. Shortly after this, that Joseph had another angel come to him and tell him that he must take his child and his wife and flee away because there was great danger that lurked there. We went quickly. We went to Egypt. We fled that very night into Egypt. And there we learned the wicked King Herod had ordered all male infants to be killed. We remained there for several months until we learned it was safe to return. But upon returning, we learned that the wicked King Herod's son was now ruler. It was not long until we knew his wickedness was just as great. And so Joseph and I took our little child. We went into the northern of the Holy Land and into Galilee and back to Nazareth, our own city. I do remember those days so well. They were happy and simple days. They were filled with great contentment. And you see, we did not have much money. And so our house was very simple in but one story. And the flat roof covered a single room. Well, it was lighted by day by a narrow opening in the wall. And at night, we lit a dim lamp that hung in the middle of the room from the ceiling. Well, against the walls were quilts rolled up by day and then unrolled by night for sleep. Much of our cooking was done outdoors. And that was easy to do because the climate was very mild. The wheat we ground by hand between two stones. And the bread we baked on a hot stone. Even though we did not have much money, we had plenty of bread, plenty of fish, and fruits of all kinds. I do remember what a wonderful time that was in life. And I remember what a wonderful, precious child Jesus was. I would put a little red cap on his head and a cloak of white or blue with a sash of many colors. And he would follow me around the house as I worked or sit beside me on a mat or a little wooden stool that we had. And then, as soon as he began to talk, I taught him to pray. And then, when he was but 5 years old, we began to read the scriptures together. And there, he read of his ancestors. He read of Joseph and Ruth and David. Read of himself without realizing words spoken. He committed many of the scriptures to memory when just a small child. But you see, we did not have the whole of the scriptures, for they were too costly. Very few homes have the whole of the scriptures. But on Sunday, he went to the synagogue. And then, when he was old enough, he attended the village school. And it was held in the village church and taught by the rabbi. Every Jewish boy in our village went to such a school, as very few could not learn to read nor write. And there he learned arithmetic, and he learned the history of his nation. But most of all, he learned about his scriptures. Our son grew rapidly. He was always a good boy, quick to do the bidding of my husband and me. And he had many friends, but somehow when he was among the friends, he seemed to stand out. I don't know how to explain it, unless it was his sweet countenance, or his cheerful spirit, or his good manners. I never had to reprimand him for unselfishness, for selfishness, for haughtiness. He was such a good boy, and certainly at peace with his brothers and sisters. Well, at the age of 12, that was the dividing line between childhood and youth. When he turned 12, he was known as the son of the law, or a son of God. And you see now, he had every responsibility the same as Joseph, and he was considered an adult male. And now he could attend the Feast of the Passover, the wonderful celebration that took place in Jerusalem every year, where Joseph and I had gone every year. And we always left in April, on the eighth day of which the feast began. But now, this year, the three of us, we started out our 80-mile journey together, and it was always such an exciting thing, this annual journey to Jerusalem. Well, all of the neighbors, they would form into little caravans, and then the little caravans would grow into larger caravans, and everyone was happy and smiling and bowing and greeting each other on the street. Music and mirth enlivened our trip, and the young men sing songs, especially the young men would sing their songs that they had learned from the scriptures. And it was shortly after we had finished our feast and our business was completed that we all left our caravan and we began home, toward our home, Nazareth. Jesus had tarried in Jerusalem. And Joseph and I knew it not. Well, we had traveled for almost a day when we began to look for our son. We sought him among our kinfolk and among our acquaintances. He was nowhere to be found. Such a discovery was a new and frightening one. Oh, he had always been such a good boy and at my side and within my beck and call. Danger. Please have thy protecting hand with my lost son. And after a sleepless night, early the next morning, the caravan continued on toward Nazareth without Joseph and I, for we had returned to Jerusalem for a panic search for our lost son. And after another sleepless night, it was early the next morning, and we began looking. And after 3 hours, we found him. He was in the temple, but not in worship. But he was in the schoolroom with the rabbi. I was very anxious and quite upset, and I was the first to speak. And I said, Jesus, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, said to me, why have you said to me, wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? Even though I did not understand the answer, it was not disrespectful or unkind. I realized that on our return back to Nazareth, I, the one chosen to be this young man's wife, I must exhibit a faith far deeper than any well, or more endless than the stars. Well, upon returning to our home in Nazareth, a new part of Jesus' life began. For as all Jewish boys, he was required by law to learn a trade. And Joseph, he took him into his shop, taught him to work with his hands, and there he learned the trade of a carpenter. Oh, yes, they made stools for the homes in Nazareth, and they made yokes for the oxen, and plows for the farmer. And Joseph taught him to let none be ashamed of an honest day's toil. And they did grow so close together. But I am afraid that his brothers and sisters did not realize that in their midst they had the most wonderful being in all the world. Or else they would not have quarreled and bickered so. Now Jesus spent his early youth and manhood preparing for the ministry. There was a hill quite close to Nazareth that was 1,800 feet above the city. And Jesus would often retire there, as would he to the mountains, for prayer and meditation. And as his mother, I felt that sometimes his life was lonely among mankind. But when I would ask him, he would say, nay, mother, I am never. Your father is always with me. I am afraid I worried unduly about him. I worried about his future. I worried if he would have a family and such. Then those simple words come flooding back into my mind. Wist ye not? About my father's business. And that is how we spent our 30 years. My husband, my first son, and my other children. Carpenter shop, and they earned a good living for our family. Joseph was so proud. Well, Jesus still had many friends, and as he took journeys, he would walk along, and the farmers would recognize him on sight. Well, Jesus always went barefooted, unless the trip was too long. And he always wore a white outer garment with no stripes along the hem. The farmers would see him coming, they'd stop their work, and they would cross the field to the fence, and they would seek him.
him out as though one seeks out a learned friend or teacher. And they would tell him their troubles. And they were always amazed at the shrewd advice he offered them. Well, shortly after this, I remember, Jesus came to me. And he held out his arms, put them around him, and said, "The time has come, Annette. I must be." Jesus knew that one would precede him in his ministry, and he also knew that one would be the same one that had preceded him in birth. John, son of the aged Elizabeth. Well, John, you see, had been born to parents who were very old, and he was very young when they died. And he was a good man, and a more holy than those that lived around him. And it saddened John to see the sinning. And he did spend a lot of his 20 years in the wilderness. He said that it was a desert, and it was full of rocky mountains with no beautiful flowers like this that grew around Nazareth. Only those things that could grow without water. His only food were the locusts that leapt and flew about him, or the honey that he got out of the clefts of the rocks. His only drink was the water he got out of the streams. But as Jesus was just about ready to begin his ministry, John came out of the wilderness, and he came into the rich, green, beautiful country on both sides of the River Jordan. To the people. Oh, and the people heard of John. They came from great distances. And John told them that the kingdom of God was at hand. And they said, "But who are you? Are you the Messiah?" He would say, "Nay, one shall come after me who is mightier than I, and whose sandals I am not worthy to remove from his feet." Well, the people thought John a wonderful preacher, and they were baptized by the multitudes. Well, the day that Jesus came walking up to John, he did not recognize him. You see, they had not seen each other since they were mere boys. And as Jesus lifted his gown, began to step into the water, looked into his eyes. He said it was a beautiful countenance of love and goodness. And he knew it was. Well, he said, "Oh, it is I that should be baptized by you." But Jesus continued walking into the water. And so John did as he was asked, and he baptized his cousin. The men came out of the water. A very wondrous thing happened for both of them. For the heavens opened wide, and the Spirit of God descended in a dove and lighted upon his shoulder. And a voice from afar announced, "This is my Son, the Beloved, in whom I am well pleased." But after this, Jesus went into the wilderness as he said he wanted to be alone so that he could meditate and pray to prepare himself for this great work. Well, he said that he was among the wildest of beasts, but they seemed to sense his power, for they did not harm him. And with no food and very little water, Jesus fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. I am sure he became very hungry and desperately weak. He gained a strength recognized on the next meeting. Well, the next time we saw took place in a little town of Canaan. It was close to Nazareth. It was a beautiful little town then, but no one goes there now except for hunting wild game. Well, we have met in the home of Nathanael, and as Jesus sat with his friends that had escorted him there, and his brothers, he sat at my knee and asked, told us of the experiences he had had. Oh, my heart was so full, and I thanked God he had not changed souls. The same special closeness that we shared throughout the years, it was still there. Well, in Nathanael's home was a wedding feast and the purpose for our being there. Oh, they made the rooms beautiful with what decorations they had there. They laid carpets on the floors and the walls were hung with garlands, and all around the tables on the benches were soft cushions and soft pillows for those reclining as they ate. Well, the oil and wine was distributed to the adults and the nuts to the children. And the bride was so beautiful. She had a veil that was from the top of her head to the bottom of her feet, and her hair fell over her shoulders, as you see, was the custom of our day. The hair being the woman's prized possession. Well, I was helping serve, and we were almost through with the meal when I discovered the wine was all gone. Yeah, and knowing that that would well, very, very embarrassed not to have enough wine for their guests, I looked at Jesus and said, "Jesus, the wine is all gone." Well, Jesus answered me back with a whisper, "Mother, what would you have me do?" But I knew he would help, and I quickly turned to the servants and said, "Whatever he tells you, obey." Then Jesus told them to fill the water jugs, which they did to the brim. And then Jesus said, "Now, draw out." And they did. The water turned into wine. Later known as my son's first miracle. And I was so pleased and privileged to be there part of it. His brothers and his friends were astonished that I needed no miracle to know the divinity of my son. After this, Jesus and his friends and brothers and I, we walked to this little town of Capernaum. It was a little fishing town on the northern side of the Sea of Galilee. It was about 30 miles, and it took us about one day and a half. Though I do remember those beautiful conversations that we had, and I did keep them locked deep in my heart to ponder them. Well, after this, Jesus went from city to town, all around, and he spent long hours working and talking with the people. He seemed to just erupt into a man of love overflowing and faith without end, tolerance. Men, women, and children became to know him and love him as they sat at his feet and surrounded him on all sides. had many friends, but especially 12 friends who were true to him. They were with me all the time to hear the beautiful words spill from his lips. 3 long years, these 12 friends, or disciples as they were called, walked with Jesus. They walked where he walked, and they heard the beautiful words of wisdom that he had to share. But I am afraid that all of us who knew and loved him the most did not realize what he taught. Why, he taught us of a life without evil doing. And he taught us that we should be meek and humble and loving and kind. And he taught us that we should be chaste in thought as well as deed. He taught us so many things. He taught us of a life after this life, where man would be punished for his own sins and rewarded for their good deeds. He taught us of eternal progression. Integrity was one of the important qualities to enter the kingdom of God. And he taught us to love one another. And he taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. He did go out among the people, teaching these beautiful words of wisdom. Then came the day that it was to all end. Oh yes, we could tell that something was bothering him. His cheerfulness was ebbing, and something seemed to be weighing him down and troubling him, his whole soul. And when we asked him about it, he said that his time with us short, and he must return to his Father in heaven from whence he had come. Oh, we were filled with the dread of it. But we could not believe that it would happen. I mean, after all, he was in his manhood. He was too good, too strong, and too wise to be snatched away like some defenseless child. Then he rode through one day, on the back of a small donkey. And the people that knew him and loved him, oh, they thronged in the streets, and myriads of flowers were thrown wherever they went. The little donkey had no need of stepping on the ground, for he could walk only on the carpets of flowers thrown in his way. And again, my thoughts go back to that donkey. Could he sense the excitement of the day? Did he know that he was carrying a lamb to his slaughter? A redeemer to pay the ransom? A savior to his sacrifice? And a king to his throne? This there enters into my story something that happened with one of the friends, disciples of my son. He did a thing that is so horrible to my father. I can't imagine why or how he would do such a thing for the gain of a few pieces of silver, which led to a fate not better than my son, nay, even worse than the fate of the son of my son. I find it hard to condemn him. You see, I know he must have a mother somewhere who loves him in spite of what he's done. Oh, how her heart must ache with anguish. My son should forgive those who hate us and despitefully use us. No one shall forgive. I am sure his soul must ache to the inward confines of his heart. More than enough for me to pit my hate against. Well, the betrayal of civil authorities was completed. They knew nothing of the truthfulness of the message of my son. And so they condemned him without a fair trial. And it seemed as though all hell had broken loose its bonds of fate against my son. For he was spat upon. He was maltreated and scourged and beaten. Soon soldiers were there to carry forth the sentence of death upon the cross. Not depart without showing his grace, his mercy, his understanding, and his love. For his last deed, Father, forgive you, for they know not what they do. It is on this night that I have let my thoughts wander back into the years to tell you my story. Can you feel as I feel tonight? Can you sense the emotions that run deep in my heart? The burden been greatly relieved by sharing this story with you. For I know more than I have ever known. I will live again someday. And I will live again with him. The son that I was chosen to care for all these years is a A prince of peace. Believe these things that I have told you this night. And believe. has